everybody. Joel is in Norway, and Annette and I are on the island of Hawaii celebrating my 60th birthday with our kids. We're going to be back next Sunday. I want to say mahalo to Sharon for filling in for Annette in the media booth. Mahalo to Dale and Patsy for leading worship for us this week. And mahalo to Sharon and Canute and others who are helping with the opening and closing of the buildings today. We appreciate you guys filling in for us while we're going. Hey, don't forget there's three ways to support this ministry financially. Number one, you can use what we call the Yay God boxes. Little black boxes right inside the lobby doors. As you come or as you go, you can just drop your offering in there. We don't pass a plate. We don't pressure anybody to give. You just give whatever the Lord puts on your heart to give. The second way you can give is to use the QR code or the URL that you see on the screen. You can give securely online. And the third way is to just send a check to the PO Box. It's all three easy ways to make sure our ministry is supported. We appreciate your financial support. Well, today we're wrapping up our six-part series on the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians, what Paul's love chapter. And we said in week one that the love chapter is sandwiched in between two chapters where Paul is correcting the Corinthian Christians about their incorrect and sometimes sinful actions and thoughts regarding spiritual gifts. So right in the middle of correcting them, he kind of takes this segue on the topic of love in chapter 13. And so far, he's spent 12 verses laying out for us exactly why he refers to love as, quote, the most excellent way. And so Paul's told us what real love looks like. He says real love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious. Love does not brag. It is not puffed up. Love is not rude. Love is not self-seeking. Love is not easily angered or resentful. Love is not glad about injustice. Instead, love rejoices in the truth. He says, love bears all things. Love believes all things. Love hopes all things. Love endures all things. Love never ends. Paul says, real love is mature. It's not childish. Real love puts the needs of others first. Love doesn't tear others down. Love builds others up. And Paul has pointed out how real love is far more powerful and far more important than any of these spiritual gifts that many in the Corinthian church have been valuing so highly, especially their fondness for the gift of speaking in tongues, which they have kind of promoted as the best gift, or the gift that only super Christians, or sometimes even only real Christians, get. And Paul says, listen, all of those mystical gifts will one day end, but love is forever. So you guys need to focus on love, not on the gifts. You need to practice whatever gifts you are given by the Holy Spirit, but only if you practice them in true love. First and foremost, God wants us to treat others with love. And so Paul has rebuked the Corinthian Christians for the way they've acted pridefully and childishly and selfishly toward others in their faith community that don't have the same spiritual gifts as they do. And so he strongly exhorts them to always act with love in all of their relationships, especially toward other brothers and sisters in Christ. But Paul also points out that real love for God and serving as representatives of Jesus Christ, that means recognizing that we don't know everything. Not even close, right? We have only a dim reflection of a small part of the love and knowledge that is God. Paul says, only when we die will we finally see him face to face and then fully know him as we have always been fully known by God. Until then, we need to choose humility. Well, let's be honest. We too should be convicted when we read Paul's words, right? Because we're often quick to express our love for someone, but then we don't always live out that love. It's kind of just lip service. It's easy to say we love someone. It's more difficult to show. And so before Paul returns to talking about spiritual gifts in chapter 14, he kind of wraps up his thoughts on this topic of love in chapter 13 with this very powerful statement in verse 13, 1 Corinthians 13:13. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Now remember, in the verses leading up to this one, Paul has talked about how most things are going to eventually pass away. They're going to cease to exist. He says, for example, there won't be any need for prophecy or words of knowledge or speaking in unknown tongues, because one day those are going to cease. We will be won't be needed anymore. But Paul says there are three things that will remain. Now, this word remain in Greek is meno. Meno means to stay, remain, to last, endure, survive, to be present continually, to abide. Some translations use that word, abide. It's the same word Jesus used in John 15:4 when he said, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. So this is very important. Meno carries with it the idea of permanence and eternity. So Paul is telling us about three things that will never pass away, that will never cease to exist. These three things will always be true. They will always be powerful. They will always matter. They will always be necessary, no matter what. What are those three things? You read them aloud with me from 1 Corinthians 13:13. What are they? They are faith, hope, and love. Wow, those are definitely powerful words. And we could do a multi-message sermon series on each of those words and still just scratch the surface of all that they entail, right? We don't have time to go into a lot of depth on all of them today since we're focusing just on the love part in this series. But I do want to clarify the difference between these three related words and define what they are with some broad brushstrokes. So let's talk about each of these words. Faith, hope, and love. First of all, often people get faith and hope confused. Now, they're certainly related, but they're not the same thing. So let's spend a few minutes talking about each of these three gifts from God to us, these three powerful words that Paul relates to us as the only three things that will remain forever, and talk about why he says the greatest of the three is love. But first, Paul says, faith will remain. And the word he uses here is pistis. Translated as faith, belief, trust, and confidence. And this type of faith is always a gift from God. It can never be something that's kind of worked up by or produced by human effort. Now, some faith healer preachers, they'll tell us that we just need to have more faith, right? We need to conjure up bigger faith within ourselves in order for God to work bigger miracles in our life. That's false teaching. That's not a biblical picture at all. Look at Romans 12, verse 3. Paul says, for by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. Paul says, we each have a specific amount, a measure of faith given to us, distributed to us by God. So it's never about us drumming up more faith, right? It's about us fully trusting and using the faith we have already given to us by God. After all, it doesn't take a lot of faith to get through life anyway. Jesus said in Matthew 17:20, because you have so little faith, truly I tell you, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. Do you know how incredibly small a mustard seed is? In another passage, Jesus refers to it as the smallest of seeds. So here's a mustard seed next to a U.S. penny. That's pretty tiny, right? In fact, if we were careful to arrange them, we could fit about 50 of these mustard seeds on the surface of just one penny. It's pretty small, yeah? And Jesus says, quit worrying about having more faith. Quit worrying about having enough faith. Because listen, if you have faith just the size of one mustard seed, you can tell an entire mountain to move, and it will do it. So he says, nothing. Everybody say, nothing. Turn to your neighbor and say, nothing. Turn to your other neighbor and say, nothing. Nothing God tells you to do will be impossible for you if you have even a mustard seed amount of faith. So what does that say about the faith healer idea that if only you had more faith, you would have received the miracle healing you asked for? Really need a lot more faith? Or is it likely that God has already given you more than enough faith for all of your needs? Because faith is simply trusting God in whatever he does or does not do in your life. That's faith. We just need to exercise the faith we do have. Yeah? Now, don't miss this, though. This faith is different from human belief or human confidence, but it does involve no matter how much faith you had, one mustard seed or 1 million mustard seeds worth, you can't get God to do anything other than what God has already committed to do. You can't hold God's feet to the fire and name it and claim it and blab it and grab it and get your way. That's not what faith is, despite what the name and claim it guys, the prosperity guys, know. Now, in ancient secular usage, this same word in Greek referred to a legal guarantee or warranty. And we can see this applied in Scripture as well. Is this faith? Is God's warranty to us? It's God's guarantee to us that He will always follow through with everything He's promised to do. Not everything we want Him to do for us, but everything He's promised to do. And the root word of this word, pistis, is faithful, which means to persuade or to be persuaded. And this is really the heart of our faith. Faith, at its core, is divine persuasion. We can't come to faith on our own. It's a gift of God. We're divinely persuaded because of God's own faithfulness that we can have faith in Him. And exercising our faith in God allows us to see and understand God's preferred will for our lives. And our prayers are answered affirmatively more often because of the nature of what we begin to ask. We stop asking for things that are outside of God's will, and we start simply asking for His will to be done. And then, surprise, surprise, that's exactly what happens. His will, that which was going to happen anyway. And that's what Paul is talking about in Romans 12:3, when he writes, "Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And then," he says, "you will be able to test and approve and know what God's will is." And he reminds us, God's will is always good, pleasing, and perfect. And then we already read the next verse earlier, but let's add it again in context. Paul says, "For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you." And then the author of Hebrews also tells us this about faith in Hebrews 11:6. He says, "Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see." He says, this is what the ancients were commended for. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him. Now, why should we believe He exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him? Because that's what He's promised us. That's what He's told us. Faith is the confidence that God is exactly who He says He is, and that He will always do everything He promises to do. Faith also has an element of assurance, right? Certainty and confidence, evidential value, substantiating the things we hope for. With faith, there's no strain, there's no tension, there's no uncertainty. If you're trying to persuade yourself to keep from doubting, you can be quite sure that that is not faith at work. Faith is not the law of mathematical probability. Faith is not natural. Faith is spiritual. And faith, again, is the gift of God. So belief and faith, while certainly closely related, they're not equivalent identical terms. When Jesus told the people, "Your faith has made you well," faith was still His gift to them. But any gift, however, once received, becomes the possession of the recipient, right? And now we become responsible for using it, putting it into action. So the faith that Jesus Christ gives to us, once accepted and put into action, that then becomes our belief. So that makes sense. But it all still starts with faith that can only come as a gift from God. So when we put it all that together, it's clear. Literally, Jesus intended it this way. "My gift of faith, now operating within you, with your consent, acceptance, involvement, and action, all of which we call belief, is what made you well." See the difference? And Paul assures us this kind of faith, true faith, given to us by God, will never disappear. He says it will abide, it will remain, it will function forever. And we can also have that confidence that our Creator is exactly who He has presented Himself to be. That will be true for all eternity. He will always do everything everything he has promised to do. You can count on that. Nothing can change that. And then next, Paul says, hope will also remain forever. And as we've said several times already, again, hope and faith are closely related, but they're not the same thing. And the word Paul uses here for hope is elpis. Elpis can be translated as hope, expectation, or trust. Now, we often use this word hope differently in our culture than the way Paul is using it here. For example, we'll say, boy, I sure hope I win the lottery. I sure hope I live until I'm 100. I sure hope I get that new job, right? That's not biblical hope. The biblical hope Paul is referring to is an expectation of what is sure or certain to happen. Biblical hope is when we know something's going to happen and we're waiting with eager anticipation and expectation. We're waiting with bated breath for what we know is going to happen. So think of it as knowing you just walked in on your surprise party that wasn't really a surprise to you, right? You can see the darkened silhouettes of the balloons and the guests and the cake in the room, and it is your birthday after all, right? You have hope that a surprise birthday party is about to break out because you can see the profound evidence that that's about what's to happen. That's what's about to happen. So that's the kind of hope Paul's talking about, right? You know, any second, the lights are going to pop on, all of your friends are going to jump up and shout, surprise! You know it's going to happen. You just don't know exactly when it's going to happen. And then you'll receive your presents, your cake, right? Biblical hope, like biblical faith, is based on the promises of God. And primarily, when this word elpis is used in the New Testament, it's referring to our joyful and confident expectation of our eternal salvation. That's usually the way it's used. Paul wrote these words in Ephesians 2, 11 through 12. Therefore, remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth, called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision. And he points out that's done in the body by human hands. Remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. So let's talk about that. What does he mean? In what way were these Gentiles without hope? And again, the hope they were missing was the hope of eternal life. Why? Because they had no relationship with Jesus Christ. They could have hope in other things, but they could not hope in eternal life and salvation. Not yet. And Paul goes on to say in that letter that both Jews and Gentiles have now been brought near to God and given access to God the Father through the sacrifice of Jesus on our behalf. And now, because of what Jesus has done, we can all, Gentiles and Jews alike, we can all have that hope in our eternal life. How? If we accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Now, Viktor Frankl was a Jew who had lived in Nazi Germany, and he was arrested and sent to a Nazi death camp. There he watched men live in inhuman conditions. He saw many who were stronger than he was eventually wither and die. And he learned valuable lessons about survival. One of the key things he observed was the power of hope. Now, I should point out, this was not specifically the hope in eternal life in Christ that we're talking about, but certainly it was the idea of having hope that there would one day still be a better future than a life after the concentration. And Frankl found that those who could maintain that kind of positive hope for their future could survive almost anything the Nazis dished out. But those who lost that hope, they quickly died. Frankl put it this way. He said, the prisoner who had lost hope in the future, his future, was doomed. With his loss of belief in the future, he also lost his spiritual hope. He let himself decline and became subject to mental and physical. Now, there's a famous, while very cruel, but a famous animal psychology experiment that demonstrates the power of hope for surviving difficult and painful circumstances as well. It's been repeated many times in the past, but it started in the 1950s. A guy named Kurt Richter took some rats, and he placed them into a bucket of water, and they couldn't get out of the bucket of water. It was too far down, there was no way to climb out. And he timed how long they would tread water on average before they finally gave up from exhaustion and drowned. Once he had had that benchmark of knowing when that was going to happen. Right at the moment they were about to give up, he would reach in and rescue them. And he would hold them for a while, and he'd help them recover. And then he placed them back in the buckets, and he timed how long they swam this time before they gave up and were drowned. And he discovered that this hypothesis was correct. When the briefly rescued rats were placed back into the water, boy, they swam and swam and swam for much longer than they had the first time that they were placed in the buckets. And he concluded that the only thing that had changed was that they had been saved once before, so therefore they had hope this time they would be saved again. They held it there long. And Frankl, he said, he found out the same thing. Once people give up all hope of being saved, they also give up on everything else. And for us as Christians, especially when times of persecution come, our hope of salvation and eternal life is what will keep us strong to the very end. Without hope, we're in trouble. Also, something fascinating about hope in Romans 8, verses 20 through 25. He says, "For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it." Let's pause there. He's really saying all of creation was subject to the curse, right? That happened way back in chapter 3 of the book of Genesis in the Garden of Eden. You see the birth of human sin when the man and the woman disobey God and they eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And that free will human decision to sin led to human separation from God because of that sin. Holy God cannot be united with anything sinful or unholy. So this distance is placed and God. And before Jesus came to set things right, there was this incredible frustration in all of creation, this real and tangible separation between us and God. And human beings were longing for something better to come, for their right standing with God to be restored, but having no power of our own to make it happen, that was understandably very frustrating and very discouraging. And yet Paul says the whole creation, including you and me, before we met Christ, we're living, but in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God. Now, what was our hope? Where did that hope that we would be liberated from our bondage to sin come from? Where did that hope that we would be freed from the consequences of our own sinful acts and that we would be adopted back into the family of God as His children come from? It came from the promises of a Messiah that God had made to His creation. Paul says, "We know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit, the first Christians, right, the first followers of Jesus, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption to sonship, the redemption of our body." That's the hope human beings had, and that's the hope we have now, that we will one day be fully adopted by God back into His family for all eternity. Despite our sinful rebellion, we will transition into the next life that's fully forgiven, fully redeemed from our sinful condition, made joint heirs with Christ in the new world. Why would we have such a hope? Why would we have such an expectation? Why would we think this was even possible? It's because this is the promise that Jesus made to us when He invited us to follow Him. He offered us the hope of salvation and reconciliation. Paul continues. He says, "For in this hope we were saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. Even though if Christ doesn't return, all die on this earth one day, there is an eternal life beyond the grave still waiting for us. And we can know this with expectant hope because Jesus promised us. He guaranteed that's what's going to happen. So we can have hope. We can have a confident expectation that it absolutely will come to pass. And Paul reminds us we can't hope for something we already have. If we already have it, why would you hope for it? You already have it. Even though we haven't yet realized that full promise of eternal life yet, we can wait for it and we can hope for it with absolute confidence and assurance that it is waiting for us one day. So messages persevere through everything here. If you feel like you're drowning, keep paddling. Don't give up. Hope is hope only if it's in something that's not yet fully seen and received, and only if it's in something trustworthy. And interestingly, Paul tells us the Corinthians, he tells the Corinthians and he tells us that hope, like faith, is something that will never go away. Why? Because no matter how much of God we experience, when we finally go to glory, there will always still be more of God. No matter how long we live in eternity, there will still be more life coming. Hope will always remain, and hope will always be important. And then finally, Paul says, love will remain. That's what we've been talking about for 6 weeks, right? Love, again, is the main point of Paul here in 1 Corinthians 13. Paul said everything else he has said in order to say this. This is the big idea. The word he uses here now is agape. Agape can be translated as love, or as benevolence, or as goodwill, or as esteem. It's a love that centers in moral preference. This is the love that God prefers, right? And you've probably heard over the years that there are three different Greek words for love. But there are actually six different words in Koine Greek that we could translate as love, but only four of them were in wide usage in Paul's time, and actually only two of them occur in the New Testament. The four basic Greek words for love are eros, storge, philia, and agape. And all of them are translated in English as love, but each focuses on a different nuance of love. For example, eros is not used in the New Testament. It refers to sensual or sexual attraction. So eros is not, in and of itself, an evil thing, of course, practiced within the bounds of marriage between a husband and a wife. It's the way God intended eros love and the way he intended it to be used. In that context, it's good, it's powerful, it's a bonding type of love. Unfortunately, humanity has used this type of love, eros, outside of God's intended purposes, and in general, given it a bad reputation. It's where we get words like erotic and erotica from, and it's usually associated with things like pornography or promiscuity. And that wasn't God's original intent. Eros was and is still a good thing within the marriage covenant. However, even by the time of the New Testament writings, it was seen as a negative, worldly idea, and so it wasn't even used by biblical writing. Then there's storge love, which is a word that refers to familial love that the parent has for their child, children, parents, siblings for one another, spouses for each other. It's that family love of unity, commitment, protection. Now, this word storge, it isn't used in the New Testament either. However, its opposite, estorge, is used twice, referring to people who act without love for their family, people who are devoid of affection for their family, people who don't show affection even to their closest relatives. And it refers to people who are kind of hard-hearted or unfeeling. Then there's the word phileo, which is a New Testament word, and it means to love, it means to kiss in regard with affection, to cherish. It's really the love of friendship, where we often refer to it as brotherly love, right, sibling love. It's different from storge love, which occurs naturally due to familial ties, right? Well, of course I love them, they're my kids, they're my flesh and bone, my blood, right? That's storge love. But phileo is a deep friendship that grows over time with those that we're not necessarily blood related to, all because of like-mindedness in life. Now, this happens in solid churches. This happens in solid Aloha group settings, for sure. We connect with people in life. We begin to think of them as our ohana, right? Our family, our brothers and sisters. When we refer to people sometimes in white as our Hanai daughter or our Hanai son, that's also phileo. I'm sure you've all heard of the city of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. It's nicknamed the city of brotherly love. That's because that's what its name actually means in Greek. Phileo, brotherly love. Delphos, or Delphia, city. Philadelphia, city of brotherly love. Let's come back to agape love that I mentioned a little bit ago. If you've been in church for any significant part of your life, I'm sure you've all been taught that agape love is the highest, most pure form of love. It's God's kind of love. It's more than a feeling. It's an act of the will. It is to love the unlovable. and is to love even when love is not returned to us. This is the love that allows us to even love our enemies. This is the love that God has for his people, and that prompted the sacrifice of his only son, Jesus, for our sins. Jesus was essentially agape love personified. And the type of love Paul is describing throughout 1 Corinthians 13 is agape love. Certainly the highest, purest, most idealized, profound kind of love we could possibly imagine. Since John told us early on in this series that God is love, it shouldn't surprise us that love would be among the final three things that would endure and remain for all eternity. God is eternal. God is love. Therefore, love is eternal. It also shouldn't surprise us that Paul says, of these three things, faith, hope, and love, the greatest of these is love. Why? Again, it's because God is love. While hope and faith and love all proceed from God, the Bible doesn't say God's core nature is faith itself. No, faith is the confidence we have in God. Likewise, God's core nature is not hope itself. Hope is the expectation we feel in our assurance that what we have faith in is going to come to pass. God is not faith, God is not hope, but God is love. God is love personified. He gives us faith. He gives us hope. He gives us love. But he is love. Everything starts with love. Everything starts with God. He is love. And so while God gives us faith, hope, and love, which will all last forever, the greatest of these, what Paul calls the most excellent one, is love. Because God. It's all about love, 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 love. It's all about love, 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 love. Everything else comes down to this. Nothing any higher on the list than love. Because after all, it's all about love. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for this series, these 6 weeks that we've talked in depth about Paul's 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians. Really digging deep for what true love is really all about and how we can practice it in all of our relationships, but especially our relationships with brothers and sisters in Christ and in our personal relationship with you for your Son, Jesus Christ. I pray for everyone here today who maybe has not started a personal relationship with Jesus as their Lord and Savior yet, that today would be that day that they would receive the love that he has shown them, that he has offered to them, and that he has modeled for them, and they would have faith in him, put their faith, their trust, their confidence that he is who he says he is, that he'll do everything that he's promised to do. I pray that that would then be building up hope in them, hope for their eternity, hope for their salvation, and that that love that comes only from you would grow within them, that they might be fully devoted followers of Jesus Christ and truly know how to love one another. I pray that everyone who's ready to make that commitment to Jesus today would say right now, me too, God, me too. Jesus, I ask you to be the Lord and Savior of my life. Be my best friend. Be my adopted brother. Teach me how to live my life. Show me how to love the way you love. God, I pray that for all of us that we would renew that commitment to say, Jesus, I want to love the way you model love. Show me how to fulfill this new command that you gave us to love one another, not as humans typically love, but love in the way that you know us love. That's my prayer for all of us today. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, aloha, guys. We'll see you next Sunday. Get ready to have some closing